go to Spanish language mass with you. And so we'd round up the Marines around 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we'd go to Spanish language mass. And we'd sit there, you know, Ei con spirito tuo, and all this, and so, man, that sounds a lot like Latin. And I can follow along with this actually makes sense. And this was before, of course, they released the new translations, the new English translations. I was like, why is it that the Spanish language translation seems to match the Latin so much, but the English doesn't look anything like it? I had to wait a couple of years to find out why. It was because our translation was bad. And that actually will come up a little bit later in the talk. That's actually something to keep in mind whenever you hear something and you think you understand it. Realize it may not really be translated quite the way you think it is. So anyway, come December 12th, actually 9 days before, they started novena to Our Lady of Guadalupe, which was wonderful. It was wonderful because we'd process from the chapel, which was like this bomb shelter kind of thing, with the statue of Our Lady in the desert with, we have electric candles, we couldn't have like lit candles, but we'd process and we'd sing in Spanish and we'd do these readings in Spanish. And by the way, I don't really speak Spanish. But, you know, I could follow along pretty much, and you have an English translation next to it, and it was great, but everything was in Spanish. So I was amazed at this love and devotion these folks had. So I wanted to learn more about Our Lady of Guadalupe. And Our Lady has, in her maternal love, has reached out to me and my family many, many times. So these are some important prefaces. Because one of the other things I want to point out is that one of the underappreciated apostles is St. Thomas. So he's the kick the tires apostle. I'm very much a skeptic on a lot of things. So hopefully we'll find a little balance as we go through this presentation, and this will make some sense to you. Hopefully you'll come away with something. I think the key thing is really this starting slide. We're gonna have to kill that. And you say, what in the world? That is not Spain. That's not Mexico. What in the world could that possibly have to do with anything about anything? Well, the other subject that sort of led to this particular talk this evening was talking about how Our Lady of Guadalupe ties into the Crusades. And there are a lot of people who are like, oh, you know, those Crusades, there's those evil, terrible Catholics doing all those evil, terrible things. Not so much. So if you look at this map, this is actually going into France around the year 732. So this is a long time ago. And this is the northernmost extent of the Muslim expanse into Western Europe. They made it to Tours before the hammer fell on them. So this is Charles Martel. He turned the tide at Tours and Poitiers, and they actually started forcing the Muslim back out of Western Europe. This was bloody fighting. Now, the date, I mean, 732, you gotta really put that in your brain as we go through this talk. Because this was brutal fighting. And this was, there was no quarter asked and none given. Whole villages were decimated, heads were stacked outside of them. I mean, this was combat, 732. So flash forward over 700 years before you even get to Christopher Columbus. That was the fight. Now this map of the Islamic Caliphate, no, this isn't from CNN yesterday, that particular caliphate is much smaller. But I want to draw your attention to the little kingdom of Asturias in sort of northern Spain. If you read Warren Carroll's History of Christendom, you just fall in love with these people. It's amazing because out of these little rocky holes they're like our Al-Qaeda maybe, these little rocky holes in the mountains, these guys were able to fight back what's called the Reconquista, where they were able to take back the Iberian Peninsula. Really very, very important, because after they beat them out of north of the Pyrenees, they beat them out south of the Pyrenees and threw them back across the Mediterranean. The last place to fall was Granada. And does anyone know when that fell? I just want to throw out a year. 1492, 732 to 1492, 760 years of total war. We've been at sort of war for, what, 14 years? 13 years, really. We haven't gotten 14 yet. And everybody's all, oh, this is so terrible. 760 years of total war. Keep that in mind. Which then leads us to these three people who, the third one, obviously, because Satan just doesn't want to see the servant of God, Isabella, be shown, she's been cut off of this from the computer. So I'll give you that one. So she is Queen Isabella, as Isabella and Ferdinand, for the Knights of Columbus, of course, the daughters of Isabella are sort of our sister league, if you will, as far as the Knights of Columbus. My grandmother was a past director for the Daughters of Isabella. I didn't even know who they were, so I had to kind of look them up. So I'll give you her. All right, but who's this guy on the left there, top left?
Columbus.
Yeah, Christopher Columbus. Hopefully, you know, Knights of Columbus, we should kind of know. This is sort of how he's depicted and all that. Who's this guy on the bottom? What's that? Not Magellan.
Cortez.
Hernan Cortez. Very good. That's outstanding. How would these three people be related? Any thoughts?
Discovery and conquest of Mexico.
Yes. Particularly Cortez in actually doing it, of course. Mm-hmm. And then Columbus in sort of getting them there. So something drew him out of himself. If you read his history, he was a little bit of a shiftless character. But something called to him, and in spite or despite of what everyone else thought, he went to Ferdinand and Isabella and said, we need to go west. And I want you to think about this for a second, because sometimes we're called to do things we don't really understand why we're doing. We'll come up with all kinds of explanations. They'll sound really good, but maybe that's not really why we were called to go do it. I just want you to keep that in mind, because when history judges Columbus so harshly, I think we need to take a step back and say, okay, what was it that was accomplished through him, even if he maybe didn't understand exactly what was going on? Because I think that is very, very important, because really, those three people all met together at varying times in this area of Spain. I'm actually really happy, because we apparently have some people know this history really well. What region of Spain is this?
Andalusia?
No. I love that word, because when I was in Dubai not too long ago and I was reading an editorial page, they referred to this whole area, this Spain thing, as Al-Andalus. They still think of this as Andalusia. Just keep that in mind. But no, this particular region is called Extremadura. And these guys are tough. This is a region where the conquistadors came from. Not all of them, but a lot of them. Cortez came from here. This was one of the areas that was sort of a border region as they were pushing the Muslims south. 760 years of total war bred some very, very tough people. And that's important. I think that is very important. The other thing about this region that is just fascinating to me is the Black Madonna. There are many of these actually in Europe, and Częstochowa in Poland. There's a whole bunch of them. But there's one here particularly from Extremadura. In 711, as the Muslims were driving north, the city of Seville was taken. The Bishop of Seville had been given this icon of the Blessed Virgin by the Pope, who this actually was one of many artworks created by Luke, the evangelist. Oh, by the way, he's a physician. I'm just throwing that in there. But anyway, so there are a number of these. Our Lady of Palermo. I mean, there's a number of these images around. So this was actually in Seville. But rather than let it fall into Muslim hands, the priests went up into the hills above a certain river that I'm going to talk to you about in a second, and buried it. And buried it. In the 14th century, this guy, by the name of Gil Cordero, got an idea. I need to go over to this place and dig. Now, I was going to find the news clipping thrown in here, and this is, by the way, this will be penance, or I guess payback, for the very short talk I gave the last time. about, I don't know if you guys heard about these kids who were playing in the snow, and the snowplow went by and just buried them. This just happened. I mean, this was about a month ago. And it was out in New York, where they had the, like, 7 feet of snow. So these kids are out playing in the snowplow. Hey, we're doing some snow. Oh, I want to build a snowman. I'm under 5 feet of snow. Think about that. And the parents didn't know where they were. I mean, it was like a couple of hours. And then the parents started realizing something was wrong. Everybody goes out looking for him. It's just snow. This guy who was walking with him goes, I need to go dig over there. For no reason. There was no marker. And he dug straight down and found the kids. He dug straight down and found the kids. And they survived. They both of them survived. There were two kids that were buried. 3 hours they were under the snow. Somebody just goes west, finds them. And I throw that out there because when Mary says, am I not your mother? Think about that. She's like, I got it. I got it. Let me handle it. So here's this guy, Gil Cordero. And he goes out, climbs over this river. And he goes up the hill. And he digs up this. And they go, oh, wow, that's pretty cool. That's the Black Madonna. And so they've enshrined it. Now, King Alfonso the 11th, who was part, you know, a massive part of the Great Conquista, he actually built a massive shrine to this, to Our Lady, who he attributed his victory in battle to. That's a common theme. I just want to mention that. When you hear the images of Our Lady as the Ark of the Covenant, that I think Scott Hahn very eloquently talks about, it just resonates with me on this stuff, because I mean, she was flat leading armies and they were winning. So this shrine, it's one of the largest shrines in Spain. What is this shrine? What's the name of this shrine? And then realize this is in the 14th century. Nobody's heard of America. This is Our Lady of Guadalupe. Now, the plot thickens. Guadalupe is the name of this river that runs through the region of Extremadura. It can have a variety of meanings for the name, and that we're going to talk about the names for Guadalupe and where they come from. But it most likely is Arabic, meaning the hidden river, Wadi al-Yuj. I don't remember that. Wadi. But then they say, well, it might be a combination of Arabic and Latin, Guadalupe, Wolf River. That sounds really specious to me. I don't believe that. I think it's probably hidden river. It's down in the mountains. It's kind of hard to find. Makes sense. Arabic name. Got it. Guadalupe. And did you hear the name Miriam before? Yeah, that's, you know, kind of a Mary you might hear in Arabic. So there's a lot of crossovers Mary's bringing into the equation here. There's Seville. I just thought I'd put that on the map. Obviously, that fell fairly early during the invasion of Western Europe. So, after the Reconquista was accomplished, all of a sudden they launched all these voyages of exploration. Prince Henry the Navigator out of Portugal, it needs to be mentioned, he was a crusader. These were crusading fleets. We can give another talk on that in the future. There's a whole lot of history behind this that has been lost and suppressed, but it's there. I'm not making this up. This isn't some conspiracy theory. The bottom line is these people were trying to get, well, that's 1492, just for fun. No, they were trying to get here to Ethiopia to rally behind the besieged Christian kingdom and land troops there. The Portuguese actually did. They were very effective, and then the Portuguese launched all their explorations in the Indian Ocean out of Ethiopia, establishing a base in Goa, and that's another talk. But if you look on the far right of the map that's cut off, there's the Philippines. Everybody knows what the Philippines are. They're out in the Pacific. That's where the Spanish actually had gotten so far west that they met the Muslims coming east and stopped them there in Mindanao, in the southern Philippines. And there's a whole lot of history on that. We'll leave that for another day. Because we're talking about Hernan Cortes. So, Columbus has this idea to go west. And of course, people are like, oh, the world was flat. You're going to fall. Everybody's stupid in Europe. No, they knew the world was big and round. And that if there wasn't a large land mass, they were all going to die. So they weren't too excited about sending them out that way. Now there were hints. They had a lot of hints that, there was in fact a large land mass out there. But still, it was a little sketchy. Columbus set out, and after four voyages, he retired basically into some ignominy in Spain. But actually probably saw the Yucatan. Certainly landed Hispaniola, set up a colony from whence they then went to Cuba, and then they fully colonized Cuba. And basically all of the explorations then of Central South America up into the southern United States region, all was really out of Cuba. That was their base of operations. Prior to coming here, actually that shrine of Our Lady of Guadalupe in Extremadura, that was where Ferdinand and Isabella met with Columbus. They met with him at that shrine. That's where they said, you go, you have this assignment. When Columbus went back to Spain, again, prior to Cortez and prior to this, by 30 years, he went back to the shrine of Our Lady Guadalupe to give thanks for her protection and guidance during the voyage. This is important, I think, me, myself, personally. So, Cordoba was the first one, probably 1517, had an expedition to the Yucatan region. Because they, again, Columbus had seen what probably were Mayan traders, and he decided rather than go north, he went south. Not such a good plan. And again, Mary had led him where he needed to go, and he did what he needed to do. At this point, it was left to someone else. Cordoba, when he lands on the Yucatan region, he discovers that the people who live there are well organized, well armed, and sacrifice humans. So he barely made it back to Cuba and then died, but they were able to carry the message of what they had found. So Cortez came with a little more firepower when they landed this next time. It still was not huge. I mean, they were outnumbered some 200,000 to one, depending on how you count the able-bodied Aztecs. And when you say, well, the Spanish had gunpowder and horses, well, I'll show you what that looks like when a causeway is being pulled out from under your horse in a second. I mean, and the gunpowder only lasts so long, although they did find a way to make gunpowder in Mexico during their explorations. One of the guys decided to run up a volcano just for fun. And he said, hey, we got saltpeter, we can make gunpowder. Good on us. This little flyer, I guess, you can find on people's houses all over the place in Mexico. No, certainly not. It says, we at this house worship Huitzilopochtli, who is the sun god or war god. He was one of the people that they often would sacrifice people to. He said, we won't accept Christian propaganda, Catholic propaganda, Protestant propaganda, or any other sect. We're not going to, again, I speak a little Spanish. I can read this. So unless you want to be sacrificed with your heart cut out and be offered to our Lord, then don't knock. Lord Huitzilopochtli blesses this house. So this is actually recent. I mean, this I didn't dig this up out of a museum. And of course, we have a nice picture here of them ripping the hearts out of someone. When Cortez was meeting the Aztecs for the first time, they weren't really sure who he was. And really, that's another time. It's a long time. If there's a book by Warren Carroll specifically on Our Lady of Guadalupe, very worth reading, a whole lot of detailed history of Cortez's military conquest of Mexico. But one of the things was they thought he was a god. And so since he's a god, he should demand sacrifice. So they took three people and ripped their hearts out right in front of him. They can take the heart out of someone in 15 seconds. There were 80,000 people sacrificed over 4 days in 1487. And they marched them up and they cut their hearts out. The bodies fell down. I mean, it was quite horrific. So Cortez and his people were horrified when they saw this, of course. Mass was said, and they realized the fight was on when they saw that. So some of the illustrious gods, Tezcatlipoca, Quetzalcoatl. Quetzalcoatl, you see all the important parts of him here, not such a big deal. Feathered serpent. A lot of the history here, you'll get conflicting reports. Quetzalcoatl is he's the head guy. Quetzalcoatl actually is the renegade rebel. Quetzalcoatl is the image of Jesus. I mean, you get all kinds of stuff. I don't know. They did, in fact, sacrifice people to Quetzalcoatl. Tezcatlipoca was a god of the moon. God with small g, of course. But who cares about these guys? These aren't the people we really care about when we're talking about Our Lady of Guadalupe. So, for our Mexico scholars, Spanish scholars, Latino scholars, this represents whom? No? So it's a little hard to tell, and actually, I just call that divine providence because you can't see the whole image of this. This is pretty horrifying. But this is Tenantzin Coatlicue. Coatlicue. This is our dear mother of the serpent skirt. So the artist's representation with a human hand, human hearts, human skull. This is what their priests wore. This is what they decorated their idols with. So this is pretty horrifying stuff. I don't know if you've ever looked at despair.com. Some of the stuff's pretty entertaining. One of the things that you do have to say for the Aztecs, seriously, there is something that people are getting and they are warping it. That's the demonic in it. There's some element of truth. And one of the things the Aztecs understood was sacrifice. And see if this sounds familiar to you. The universe is out of balance, and to balance it requires blood. Does that sound familiar? No? Let's talk about original sin. Let's talk about the atoning sacrifice of Jesus Christ. They actually got that, but they got it warped into they had to feed the gods. But they were an amazing culture, an amazing amazing engineers. They never developed the wheel. Despite having never developed the wheel, they had amazing cities, amazing buildings. Unfortunately, the causeways, as they collapse, and you're trying to escape the city, it was a great defensive posture for the Aztecs, and it was really hard on the Spanish horses. And the problem is that if you were a Spaniard at this time and you got caught, they were really happy to sacrifice you. So there are a number of Spanish soldiers, missionaries, who were sacrificed to these demons. So this was, again, but Hernan Cortes and his people, they're used to total war. They get it. These are some very, very tough people. So when you have 400 people, and they got reinforcements from Cuba, and but still, you're talking at most about 2,000 Spanish that ended up taking over several hundred thousand armed warriors that were very skilled in combat. A lot of good ways they did that. You would think, after being released from this bondage to demons, that the Spanish would be just having to have mass baptisms, how everyone would want to become Catholic at this point. I mean, I'd be like, man, I want to be what you are. Well, there might have happened for a day or two, and then the Spanish landlords set in. And the Franciscans were horrified at the treatment of the locals. In fact, Bishop Zumarraga, a Franciscan, was actually banned from communication with Charles V back in Spain. He had to sneak letters out to communicate how badly the locals were being treated. So for 10 years after the fall of Tenochtitlan, there were about 40,000 converts, 50,000 converts over 10 years. One of them's this guy. Nice, I'm glad I put that in the middle. Yeah, you all know him. Coatlicue. Coatlicue. You know him, right? Yeah, the eagle who speaks. Absolutely. What's his name? Spanish name? Juan Diego. Absolutely. So he was actually, he and his wife, Maria, I do not know her Nahuatl name. I apologize, actually. It's an oversight on my part. But Maria were baptized in 1524. So about 3 years or so after the fall of the empire. He was about 45 years old at this point, and his wife died about 5 years later. So We get down to 1529, 1530, 1531. He's walking along, he's going to church. He's got to walk about 6 miles. Actually, we went down to Mexico City and we could kind of see, okay, well, this is where the church was, this is where he lived. That's a heck of a walk. And I didn't know this until I got down there. Mexico City is really high altitude. It's in the Mexican Valley, or Valley of Mexico, but it's still higher than Denver. So she appears, and there's a lot of ways you could read this particular interaction, but basically she says, you know, I am Mary. She doesn't give a name, and that's important, but he recognizes who she is. He recognizes her as Jesus' mother. And she tells him to go to the bishop and have him build her a house. Now, this is a minor point, but for me, it's a big point. Not up on the top of the hill, where they actually were kind of talking right now, but down on the plain, below the hill, below Tepeyac Hill, down on the plain. One of the reasons I bring that up is Tenantzin Coatlicue had a temple at the top of the hill. And so there are many people who will say, well, actually, you're worshiping this Aztec goddess. It's not really Mary that you're worshiping. Because, see, their temples in the same spot. No, actually, they're not. They're in different spots. They're in a similar location, but that's actually where Juan Diego lived. So, you know, maybe there's something there. But anyway, she says, go to the bishop. Well, of course, Juan Diego being sent, having a little clearer idea, I think, of what was expected than, say, oh, Columbus. or the guy who was digging in the snow trying to find the kids. Or, you know, Gilles Cordero. This guy's sent, and he's got a very clear mission. You're going to go to the bishop. And he says, okay. So here's the guy who's, you know, they're still abusing the heck out of the Nahuatl people, the Azteca. And he's going to walk up to this nobleman, the Spanish nobleman, and just hang out. Well, Mary told him to do it, so he did. And he walks, he knocks on the door. Of course, the servants think he's nuts. But he's pretty insistent, and he's very polite. So they let him in, he meets with the bishop. And the bishop listens to him and says, okay, so you need to go home now, and you come back later, and we'll talk about this again. So he goes back to Mary, and he walks back up the hill to meet her, and she comes to him and says, you know, what's going on? He's like, oh, I'm a failure. You got to get somebody else to go. You get somebody who's important, who they'll respect, who they'll listen to. And she says, no, I need you to do this. You are the person to carry my message, and you need to go do it. And so he does. He goes back. And of course, the servants are like, you're an idiot. But they let him in. The bishop had said that he should come back. So he comes back, he sits down, and he explains everything to the bishop. And he's very polite, at least by the reports. He's very detailed, very respectful, and answers the bishop's questions truthfully and fully. So the bishop says, I need some evidence. And Juan Diego doesn't bat an eye. He says, not a problem, what do you want? Now this is where it's interesting, because the bishop doesn't tell him. The bishop doesn't tell him. He says, she'll know. If what you say is all true, she will know. So he goes back and actually tells her right away what's going on. And Mary is, I'm thinking a couple of different names for Mary, so which one am I going to use? So Mary hears him say, I need proof. And he, of course, thinks she's going to be horrified. And, you know, how dare he insult my honor and dignity? No. She goes, come back tomorrow, and we will give him the proof that he asked for. I'm going to come back to this a little bit in a little more explicit detail, but I think it's really important, this interaction, that a lay Catholic is being asked to carry the word by our Blessed Mother with respect to the hierarchy, and that when the hierarchy demands proof, she, our Blessed Mother, provides it. So keep that in mind when we say, well, you have to believe this, or you have to do this, or how could the hierarchy do this, that, or the other? You know what? If Mary respects the bishop, I'm going to respect the bishop. Jesus respects the bishop, I'm going to respect the bishop. And I'll come back to that more in a little bit. Well, his uncle falls sick, and he actually doesn't immediately go back. He actually tries to dodge her because he wants to go get a priest to give his uncle last rites. And there's a variety, actually it's kind of interesting, there's a variety of opinions on what actually was going on with his uncle. There are some people who say he was shot with an arrow because of his conversion to Christianity. Could be, don't know. Others, he just had a fever. Could be, I don't know, I wasn't there. But something bad happened to his uncle, Juan Bernardino. I don't know his Nahuatl name either, I apologize. But she comes down to him, off of the hill. It's like he's trying to make a little edge play and get around so she doesn't see him. Goes around the other side of the hill, literally, goes around the other side of the hill. She won't see me here. Nope, she makes the beeline right for him. She comes to him where he is in his time of need. Think about that. And she says to him, "What's troubling you? Am I not your mother?" And he just lays it out. You know, his uncle said, "Yeah, I'm your mother. I got this. Now, go up there to that hill and pick up." She said, "Yeah, basically, whatever you're doing, forget about that. Go up there and pick some flowers. It's December in Mexico City. It's cold. There are no flowers." No, there are. He goes up there, and there are all these beautiful roses and flowers, and he arranges them all in. Now, his cloak, or for those of you who've heard the word tilma, I mean, it's a cloak, and they wear the cloak because it's cold, or they carry things in it because they could carry things in it. It was good size. And so he loads. Well, actually, he doesn't particularly load them. He puts them in there, but then it comes down, and actually Mary arranges the flowers the way she wants them in his cloak. And I imagine pats him on his head, sends him off to school, you know? 50-year-old man. Get along there. So he goes down to the bishop, and he's carrying all this, and they're not going to let him in. The servants are not going to let him in this time. And they're like, "Well, he's carrying something. I'm really kind of curious what that is." And they look in there, and they see there's roses in there. And so now they want to touch the roses. Now, story, the roses became part of the tilma, and they couldn't pull them out. I don't know. That sounds, anyway, a little excessive, but that's the story. But they do let him in because he clearly has something for the bishop that the bishop had requested. And he comes in, and when he unfolds his tilma in front of the bishop, the roses spill out. But they're not just roses. They're Castilian roses. And remember I mentioned that the Spanish were oppressing the people so much, and the bishop was trying to get information to Charles V, and he was trying to get support. He was trying to get support. He's despondent. The bishop is despondent, and he's praying to Our Lady for a sign. And he asked for Castilian roses. So there they were. And when they looked up from the, because he's like stunned. I mean, these roses, this is amazing. Oh my goodness, look at that image. And then they see that this image is right there. Absolutely stunned everybody there. It's amazing. At that point, the bishop takes Juan Diego into his home. They immediately set to building a shrine, which is, in varying forms has existed now for 500 years. By the way, the 500th anniversary of this is going to be in, 2031. 2017, I think. 500th anniversary, 2031. 17 years. That was the math I did. There you go. The reason I throw that out is I think, God willing, we'll all be around. That, I think, is going to be cool. But what about Juan Bernardino, the uncle? Well, this is where it gets kind of interesting because, of course, Juan Diego wants to go visit him to find out how he's doing at this point because he sort of just left him. And, of course, he understands. I mean, this is a Blessed Virgin, so it's in her hands. It's all going to be good. But sometimes it's fun to see, okay, what kind of good? I mean, what kind of good? How does this work out? So he goes, and actually the bishop has some people tailing him, and he loses them, and it's just great chain. No, he doesn't try to lose them, he just loses them. And he shows up, and his uncle's fine. Uncle's completely fine. And his uncle tells him that about the same time, Blessed Virgin appeared to him and said, "My name, I should be referred to as Our Lady of Guadalupe." So the name Guadalupe is actually given by her to the uncle. That then comes to us in this name. Because there's all kinds of stuff about why did they take a Spanish name? Well, again, as we talked about earlier, it's kind of an Arabic name, actually, just to be perfectly perfect on that. So we say, what's in a name? Well, there are people who later said, surely she didn't use a Spanish name to these people who spoke Nahuatl. So there are a bunch of different versions of what in Nahuatl would sound like Guadalupe. And I would say the Guadalupe kind of sounds like that. I would do that. But the one that's been the most prominent, Cuatlasope, I don't buy it. I just don't buy it. And the top one is right out. Okay, these are the names that mean, you know, she crushed the serpent. The bottom one is, she destroys serpents. The one above that is she crushes the head of the stone serpent. And the one above that is she defeats the great devourer. All very good names, and I love them, but they weren't the ones that she used, and there's no record of those actually being the name. Now, where that gets really kind of fascinating to me is that the Franciscan missionaries thought that there was no way they could sell this Guadalupe thing with a Spanish name. They thought they needed a Nahuatl name in order for anyone to buy into it. Now, again, they're not trying to market this at all, but it's like, how do they explain this to anyone? So I said, it's just not good. And the other thing is, there's no D or G in Nahuatl. So Guadalupe, that's crazy talk. Nobody's going to be able to say a D or a G in Nahuatl. Except, wait a second, the guy's name was Juan Bernardino. And wait a second, Juan Diego, he's got a D and a G in his name. So the point is that enough of the Spanish language had actually permeated the area where people were speaking Spanish, they were taking Spanish names, and so it's not that far-fetched. Particularly if you understand, I think, the roots of where all of this came from Guadalupe, it makes a lot of sense for her then to tell people, look, this is where this came from. So when we look at the image itself, there's a lot of stuff in it that speaks to the Nahuatl. Why? They had a pictographic language. They wrote essentially hieroglyphically. Now, when we look at this, we don't really see, actually we got that one up there, thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Mary. That image, a four-leafed iris right over her belly. So what? It's decorative. It's not a big deal. Well, to us, but when a Nahuatl person saw this image and saw the iris on the belly, iris represented the supreme deity. Now, in like many sort of Gnostic sort of religions, the supreme deity was off playing golf somewhere and didn't really care what was going on. But that was the supreme deity, and it was in her belly. Think about that for a second. What's being communicated? That and now she's pregnant, obviously, right? You're like, well, how is it obvious? Well, to us, it's not. A lot of people go, I don't get it, man. I shouldn't look all that pregnant. I mean, it's kind of a baggy dress, but, you know, if my wife was wearing that, I wouldn't say, hey, honey, are you pregnant? I'd get slapped. So, well, how do you know that she's pregnant? Well, she's wearing this cincture that is, it's plus minus on the image here, but you can see it more clearly on the icon over the standing up. That cincture to the Nahuatl represented a pregnant woman. So she's a pregnant woman with the supreme deity in her belly. Huh, that's kind of curious. There's your cincture. The other thing is she's praying. Everyone, you say, oh, she got her hands folded, she's praying. That's okay, kind of. But it's actually the bent knee that to the Nahuatl indicated that she was actually worshiping. Because she's dancing. They looked at that and saw her dance and pray, worshiping the supreme deity who was in her belly. This little primer in theology that was existing in this hieroglyphic painting is amazing, because we don't have another example of that in 2,000 years of Catholic history, where a very complex piece of Catholic theology is not just enculturated, but perfectly enculturated. So that when this image was shown, everyone knew what was being communicated. They got it, and they loved it. They loved her. She loves them. It works out pretty good. Now, the image on the bottom, you kind of see it over there, the angel or the eagle child is actually gripping her mantle or her cloak and her robe, both. And say, so what? The robe itself represents the earth for a lot of different reasons to the Nahuatl mind. And some of it is the different flower patterns represent the volcanoes around Mexico City. I would refer you to Carl Anderson's book on Our Lady of Guadalupe, because he goes into great detail about the imagery. And if you think that a Spanish painter would have painted this, he would not have known any of this. And if you think that a Nahuatl would have painted it, they didn't have this painting style, nor did they have the paints. They came together perfectly. Never any time else in 2,000 years. So this little eagle child, angel creature thing is linking together heaven and earth in this woman. Again, reflecting some very deep theology that the Azteca got. And they rejoiced. They rejoiced. And in the 10 years following this apparition, 9 million converted. 40,000-ish, maybe, in 10 years prior, 9 million converted. And in fact, when they were going up into Mexico, I mean, going up into California, which is Mexico, or going into Texas or any of these other places, they would just roll this out. And immediately, they would have conversation. They got it all across the Americas, who she was and what she represents. They rejoiced, they danced, they converted. This is actually, there was a similar, we have a couple of pictures, like this was just a really good picture, I pirated this off the internet. But when we were down there at the shrine, many groups of these dancers were down there. I'm not a big liturgical dance fan in our culture. However, it is completely culturally appropriate here. That is how the Aztec worship. And so they have these, you know, these dance troops. And of course, it's funny, I'm walking through the square there with my wife, and she's like, are those a bunch of pagans trying to corrupt things? No, no, honey, those are the locals. Down, dear, down. And that's actually the Capuchin nuns' shrine on the other side of that there. The other thing that happens in this at this point is that this battle standard of Our Lady of Guadalupe makes it quite a bit of distance. I actually was not aware of this until, gosh, a couple weeks ago, doing some research for this, but that it was actually the battle standard at Lepanto. And of course, as you know, the combined Christian Armada under the leadership of Don Juan of Austria actually defeated the Muslim fleet definitively, ending the Muslim supremacy in the Mediterranean. And that this great naval event is commemorated on October 7th, Feast of Our Lady of the Holy Rosary, Our Lady of Victories. But this was carried on the ship of Admiral Andrea Doria, given to him by Philip II of Spain to protect them and guide them in battle. I just love that. The image that was carried at Lepanto actually is still able to be seen in Aveto, Italy. So you can go look at it. It's a little different. Muy pequeño. The crown is a big deal. One of the things that I want to throw out here is that there's a lot of miraculous, as you can already tell, I mean, there's a lot of miraculous stuff around this. We don't need to invent any miraculous stuff. There have been additions and deletions and changes in the image over 500 years. Things like the crown. It's the incredible disappearing crown. You know, they say, well, that couldn't have been added because it was exactly like that when it was at Lepanto. No, it wasn't. So there are areas of the image on the tilma that have primer, that have some back drawing to show that there was a sketch made, but they're very small portions of it. So people decided that Mary's image that she gave us wasn't really good enough. We need to add some things to it. Well, they haven't really endured 500 years. So There's a lot of debate about that. So as you look at the two images side by side, they're pretty similar. There are some differences. The colors are important. The turquoise of her cloak is the color of royalty. So she is, I mean, she's depicted as queen of heaven and earth in this. She depicted as queen of heaven and earth. She also used language that would be consonant with the Immaculate Conception, although she didn't use those exact words at that time, but basically confirming what was to be defined later as dogma. I love the bent knee. I just thought that was cool. She's dancing, the dancing virgin. We love dancing, right? Dancing is cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lots of cool, miraculous stuff around this. And these are some of the things. So the first one that you got the picture of here, there was, during the Caes administration in the 20s, there was an attempt to destroy this. And a bomb was placed underneath it in a vase of roses. Well, it blew up, and it blew out all the windows in the Basilica Antigua, and it damaged a lot of stuff. It bent the heck out of this cross. The tilma, which was right above it, was untouched. And no one in the basilica was harmed. So that's pretty amazing. I'm just going to put that in the amazing category. There was an attempt at cleaning it in the 18th century, not it, but like the gold around it and sort of the casing of it. And poor guy, this is a guy you'd hate to be. He spills nitric acid in a large volume on the tilma. It's not really scarred at all. There's a little bit of discoloration in the top right, but otherwise it's still fine. But the big one that just, I can't really wrap my brain around, and again, I like to kick the tires and check stuff out. It's 500 years old. This thing's made out of Ayati cactus fiber. On the outside, we're talking 15 years, and that's if it's really protected. For about the first 100 years of its existence, this thing was slung over an altar in a very small room, basically, with burning candles right next to it, and people would kiss it and hug it, and they cut little pieces of it, and I mean, for like 100 years. And did I mention the pollution content? I mean, this sulfuric air that is in the Valley of Mexico, this thing was bathed in it. It's not hermetically sealed. I mean, it's still not. It's in a glass, you know, behind glass and stuff, but it's not hermetically sealed. It's still there, and it still looks like this for 500 years. Show me something else that's done that. There isn't. Now, I put this image up just because they have done a lot of scientific studies of this. They've looked at infrared, looking in the eyes, and optometrists and ophthalmologists, all kinds of folks looking at this. I'm really not going to get into it because I got to be honest with you, I don't really buy any of it. I just don't. You can see whatever you want when you get down pixelated enough. So it doesn't have to be that way for me. You can study this, and if that's important to you, you can look it up. It doesn't resonate with me. Part of it is I can't prove it. I can't go to that and look with my ophthalmoscope in her eye and say, yes, I see Juan Diego in her eye. And I don't need to. It's like trying to put the crown back on her, make it better than it. I don't need that. I got all this other stuff. So just barely catching this, but good enough. We go, so my wife and I decided, so I'm going to give this talk. I've never actually seen this thing. I want to kick the tires. So we get on a plane and fly down to Mexico City for 23 hours. Customs. Why'd you got no bags? You got no bags, man. Why you got no bags? I'm just here for 23 hours. I'm seeing that. I'm on a pilgrimage. I'm going to the shrine. I'm going back to Minnesota. But this was the first Sunday in Advent. Obviously a big time to be at church, right? This place was packed. The Basilica Nuevo seats 10,000 people. 10,000 people. This was packed. And they have masses every hour. 8 to like 5 in the evening. They're all packed. And my wife made the comment, she says, you know, you read the Bible and you hear about how crowds saw Jesus. And they fought to get near him. They everybody jostling and hustling to get next to him. And yet when we go up to communion,
oh, a bold man, do it all over again.
You know, I was like, what? Here? I mean, these people are on fire. They were on fire. I mean, they had little like standards that would come out. And they said, you can, you know, this is where the extraordinary ministry of the Eucharist. And let me tell you, they need extraordinary ministry of the Eucharist there because, you know, 10,000 people. and there's like 10 of them. And so everybody's like jostling to get to communion. That was pretty cool. These guys are on fire. So this is the Basilica Antigua. Just as an aside on this, this was a picture we took. This is the lake bed. This is like ancient lake bed kind of thing. So it was sinking. The thing was sinking for many years. And they actually, because it was becoming dangerous, they had to close it. In the 1970s, they built this new basilica. Interestingly, also in the 70s, there was a law passed in Mexico that all colonial era churches now belong to the state. They nationalized them all to turn them into museums.
But this one was closed.
And they built a new basilica near it, seats more people and all that. And interestingly, when they finished building the new basilica, the old one stopped sinking. Oh, and by the way, the law had been rescinded, and now they didn't get it. So actually, it's still a church. You can still go in. And this is the inside of it, up a little bit. It's actually, they have perpetual adoration there. And it's just stunningly beautiful. I mean, it's at a little bit of an angle, but that's okay. This is the Basilica Nuevo. Okay, architectural style, you know. It speaks to these folks. It's their church. Leave them alone. But they would line up out of the middle. They had communion, they had confirmation, different masses, and they would have all these folks line up the middle so they could go up the middle and be kind of seated near the altar and the toma and all that. It's really cool. We're out on the fringes a little bit. So just a comment about some things about superstition. Deviation of religious feeling of the practices this feeling imposes. Can affect worship we offer the true God. You can worship the true God in superstitious ways. I am opposed. We're all opposed to superstition. So to say that the efficacy of prayers or sacramental signs are just about their performance without interior disposition brings you into superstition. So I think that's an important thing to comment on whenever we talk about religious objects. I don't know if people are familiar in the Book of Kings, Nehushtan. Anybody raise your hand? You're real familiar with Aramaic and Hebrew and all that. Nehushtan. So when the Israel or the Hebrews were being bitten by the serpents, Moses was told to build a staff, put a bronze serpent on it, and hold it up. They began worshiping it later, and it actually was eventually destroyed. And it's in the Book of Kings. So take a look at that. So we can turn valid religious expressions, valid gifts from God, into idols and items for superstition. So we have to be careful about that. In the process of discernment, though, and as an apologist, this just came up today in the operating room. If I have to explain this to someone, how am I going to go about that? Well, one of the things I'm going to say is, well, something happened in 1531 in Mexico that changed the course of Mexican history and the history of the entire world. Something happened. The continuous history, unbroken history of this garment suggests that it was at the epicenter of this event. Now, when we think of the Shroud of Turin, one of the things we have to remember about the Shroud of Turin, we don't really have a chain of custody of the Shroud of Turin. It's difficult. That's another talk. We can give another talk on Shroud of Turin. But this, we know where it's been for 500 years. And that's very important. That this thing exists cannot be refuted. You can go look at it. There are books written about it, but you can actually go look at it. And what it is cannot be fully explained. You can have all the scientific studies you want. You can have all this stuff going. You are not going to get a scientific explanation of what this is. You cannot. So for me, messages from Guadalupe. Mary is our mother. She loves us and actively cares for us. Very much so. It may be that, like me, you get slapped on the head by your mom, but she loves you. The authority of the church is not subordinate to the miraculous. So some miraculous vision appears and, you know, the Pope is the Antichrist and I'm the new whatever. Yeah. Sit down. Not happening. And very important, Carl Anderson in his book really hits this home. The new evangelization that we're hearing about from John Paul II really began with that first Catholic couple in the Americas. They were the first Catholic couple in the Americas, Juan Diego and his wife Maria. And it continues today. It is the mission of the laity to take this message out to the world. I thank you very much for your kind attention. These are some of the reference books. The one on the far right is The Wonder of Guadalupe, and so it's not as important, so it just was cut off. But from a historical standpoint, Warren Carroll's book, Our Lady of Guadalupe, I think really, Warren Carroll's a wonderful historian. Any of his books are fantastic. And then the book by Carl Anderson, Our Supreme Knight, and Eduardo Chavez, Monsignor, great books for the history. All right, I thank you very much. Questions, issues, concerns, complaints, smart remarks, more beer.